Hey guys, today we're going to talk about ways to protect ourselves from radiation or electromagnetic frequencies. Now this is not going to be the video to convince anyone of why this is a problem. Maybe we'll make another video on that. But for now, I highly recommend reading The Invisible Rainbow, which goes into great detail on the history of electricity and the long history of documented health problems associated with that electricity. And I do also recommend the much shorter book, Zapped, as more of a handbook on finding sources of radiation in your home and in your life and ways to reduce that. But we're just going to jump right into it. There are three main ways that you can protect yourself. The first one is to minimize exposure. And here it's smart to start with the biggest sources first. In most people's daily lives, in their home or in their car or on the street, is going to be the phone in their pocket. Now the strength of EMF is basically exponential. Means any distance that you can put between yourself and your devices is good, and the more distance the better. The very first thing is never ever keeping these devices on our bodies, in our pockets, without some kind of a case. I will talk about cases in the number two thing that we can do to protect ourselves, shields. But rule number one, never put the phone in the pocket unprotected. Never put the phone directly to the head, ever. You can use headphones, not wireless. They even make EMF reducing earphones. You want to be a bit careful with those. You don't want to buy the cheap ones. Definitely spend a little bit more money or the tube will just kind of fall out. It will stop working. You can also use speakerphone instead of putting the phone to your head. And when you're just hanging out, just keep the phone away from you. Put it on the table. Put it as far away from you as you really possibly can. There are going to be other sources in the house, many of them which you can just get rid of. We're talking about minimizing exposure. If you just throw some of these Bluetooth devices or all of your Bluetooth devices and wireless devices, if you throw all or most of them away, you've greatly reduced your sources of EMF in the house. A lot of gaming consoles, basically anything newer than a PlayStation 2 or GameCube or original Xbox, is going to be constantly emitting wireless radiation, looking for a signal. Even worse is the wireless controllers. So if you're a gamer or your kids are gamers, I highly recommend going towards the older systems with fully corded controllers and that do not emit any type of a Wi-Fi or Bluetooth signal. And if you do have those in the house and do insist on keeping them, keep them unplugged when you're not using them. And I would consider desktop computer to be the safest way to game. And you can do multiplayer and online and all that stuff. And these days it seems like they're making a lot of the same games for a computer as they are for the other systems. In the best case scenario, you've got your internet connection coming in through a cable to that computer. And even better is if the tower itself, in the case of a PC, is separated from you, or you have some sort of Faraday cage around it, or something metal between you and the computer. Other things I would be aware of to minimize exposure would be anything with a radiator, like a heated blanket or heated car seats. I would avoid those. And I live in a very cold place. I understand the luxury of the heated car seats. And sometimes I will use them if it's really cold, but really we want to minimize that as much as possible. So minimizing exposure means getting away from devices as much as possible. You could expand this to looking at where you actually live. If you live very close to a cell phone tower or an electricity step down station or transfer station, or maybe you live above a subway line, those sources of radiation are so strong that you're really not going to be able to make a difference in your own house. And the unfortunate answer is that we do actually have to move. We have to get away from these things because they're not going to go away overnight. And I don't mean to get too dramatic too quickly in this video, but a lot of people living in the city, they're really going to have to consider leaving the city on an as soon as possible basis because the problem is not getting any better on the environmental scale. Though we can reduce our major sources in our own lives, such as the cell phone, we can turn the Wi-Fi off at night. We can put a Faraday cage around our Wi-Fi to reduce the signal output. And we can even switch to cable-based internet. Most people, they will have an Ethernet connection coming out of the wall, going into a Wi-Fi router. Whereas you can split that cable, connect your computers. You can even connect your phone with an Ethernet adapter. I do that for my morning messages. I have to answer a whole bunch of messages basically every day or it gets out of control. I do that in the morning, and when I'm sitting there doing all those messages on my phone, I have it plugged into the Ethernet adapter and the Wi-Fi turned off. And of course, it's on airplane mode and has the data and Bluetooth turned off permanently. Might as well bring this up. I do have a video called How to Live Without a Cell Phone Bill. And I do strongly recommend this, both for the action of minimizing the EMF exposure and also on the larger political scale of having EMF reduced is going to have a lot to do with the telecom companies and getting rid of my phone bill is one small protest that I can do, and encouraging others to do the same is a little bit more effective. Now, that conversation will almost never happen if you don't have a reason to bring it up. One excellent reason to bring it up is that you don't have a cell phone bill. I highly recommend watching this video, learning how to live without a cell phone bill. You can do it. It can save you money. It can reduce the EMF output from your phone, because each one of those functions on your phone is putting out a different signal. When airplane mode is on, that means it's no longer looking for a mobile service signal. That's just your regular cell phone signal. It's no longer putting out a signal looking for a tower, because the tower is putting out a signal looking for your phone, and your phone is putting out a signal looking for the tower, looking for the Wi-Fi, looking for the Bluetooth devices. So when you turn all of these functions off, now the phone is still bad. You still should not put it in your pocket or to your head or keep it in your lap. But the harm is much reduced by not having those signals going out. Next, let's move on to shields. Shields is the second thing that we can do to protect ourselves from EMF. Number one, we can minimize the exposure. But number two, any of those devices that we have kept around, such as our cell phones, we can strategically use shields. Now, the cell phone is one of the easier ones because many companies sell metal cases or silver-lined cases, and they actually make clothing as well, so let's talk about these in the same sentence. I know several of these companies now, and several of them have sent me sample products because I run the Instagram account all about cell phone towers called Transcend Towers. So I have tried a bunch of them out. Some are better than others. I really like the company Spiro Gear because the fabric is really nice. Some of these other ones, it feels more metallic and it looks more silver, which is not very stylish in my opinion. I don't really want to wear silver clothes looking like I'm in a future movie or something. But the Spiro Gear looks and feels very much like regular clothing. And of course, they do have phone cases. The phone case doesn't need to be as nice as fabric as the clothing, but it is nice to have a decent phone case. I've had a few of these now. Some of them are quite ugly and bulky, but I definitely recommend looking for one with at least a double lining of silver. And honestly, with today's output of cell phone towers, the strength of the signal or the type of the signal, these cases don't even fully protect a cell phone call from coming in anymore. They used to, but I do believe it's still greatly reducing it, especially if you turn some of those functions off already. And when you do have to go out, if you do need to bring your phone with you, you can keep it in the phone case and then in the purse or even in the pocket if you need to, because you've got that layer of protection now. And by the way, one of the things about not having a phone bill anymore, one of the things I actually like about it is that I don't have to take my phone outside. If I'm going out to the grocery store or something, I don't need my phone with me. I know you can't pull over and take a picture of something, but it's fine. And I don't have to worry about the case or anything like that. I just have some freedom. I can go out and enjoy the real world for most of my trips outside. Now, if you are going to look at silver clothing, it is not the cheapest in the world, and you do want to take good care of that stuff. You don't want it shrinking on you. I really like the idea of the underwear being the first thing that I would buy, or undershirts, things that protect your vitals. And these are mostly small companies making these silver clothing, so they don't have a huge variety. They don't have things like, you know, nice jackets that you could wear through a hard winter or anything like that, right? So this is why I would go for the lower layers first. And over time, these companies will start producing more pants and jackets and such that will make it easier to have a whole wardrobe in it. And I used to say that we shouldn't need to wear bulletproof vests around. We should stop getting shot at. But the reality is that the political time that it will take to get anything really done means that we need protection now. When it comes to shields, you can also shield things in your house. Any metal will basically shield EMF to a degree, even a metal mesh, you know, over a window or a wall. Foil, aluminum foil, tin foil, baking sheets, and they even make EMF protecting paint, which is quite a bit more expensive than those other options, but it is an option. Now, you can identify sources of EMF in your house. The easiest way to do it is with an EMF meter, but a decent EMF meter is kind of expensive. You're going to be paying about $350 or more, and a lot of people buy them and kind of only use them once or for one day or one week until they found all the sources around them in their daily life, and the meter kind of sits in a drawer. So if you know somebody with a meter, you can call them and ask them to use it or ask them to come by and help you find these sources. You can probably, depending on your country and county, you can probably call your local fire department and they will probably send a firefighter over for free with a really good meter to help you find sources of EMF in your home. An electrician might do it for free as well, but that's much more likely if you know them personally, because this job doesn't take very long. They don't have to fix anything or buy any parts. Now, this is especially important for sources coming in from outside. So if you are living within distance of a cell phone tower or something like that, you might have one wall in your house or one corner of one wall that has a really strong beam, so to speak, coming in. You can identify that. You can block that corner out or that wall out with mesh or foil or EMF paint. Now you can also do this on the opposite walls of things like refrigerators, microwaves, electric stoves, electric heaters of any kind, smart meters, anything like that, where you might be spending time on the other side of that wall where this device sits. You can block that wall. I put several layers of foil behind my smart meter, and I put a bookshelf in front of that, and I can go on living my life, and I don't feel any harm from that coming in. A refrigerator or a freezer is a major neglected source of EMF, and again, it's very common for a refrigerator or a freezer to be on the other side of a wall of where someone sits. Maybe it's their living room or a bedroom. So you definitely want to block one of those sides of that wall adjacent to the fridge or freezer. Now, I want to mention here that when you create a metal room, frequencies will also bounce off it from the inside. So we don't want to coat everything. We don't want to cover the house in tinfoil. That's not the point here. We want to block the few key points where EMF is coming in from the outside. And we want to block other rooms from big time emitters like refrigerators. But especially when we're in a vehicle, we should be conscious that all the signals that our phones are giving out looking for cell phone towers and Bluetooth devices, these are all sort of being trapped inside the car because the car is acting like a Faraday cage. So one great strategy, number one, you should have the phone in a case or not on you at all when you go outside is a good option. But if you do have the phone on you, it is best to turn off all of the signals so that it's not sending anything out when it's inside the car with you. Now, the third main thing that you can do is protect yourself with some form of device. Now, I am in the health business in real life, selling supplements, vitamins and minerals, basically antioxidants, stuff like that. There is a lot of people in this business who will claim that by being healthy with all the good nutrition and stuff, and even certain supplements, that this can protect us from radiation. And though it is true that certain plants, for example, do absorb radiation at a higher rate than other plants, you know, people will particularly say things like aloe, you know, they'll say put an aloe plant by your Wi-Fi or something like that. And there's also certain supplements that are said to help with this, like spirulina, chlorella, sea greens. But for the purposes of this conversation, I'm not really going to talk about that. We're going to recommend everyone try and be healthy anyways and consume all the 90 essential nutrients and avoid the bad foods and do all that stuff anyways. But I know that that is not enough to protect from radiation. I know that there are a lot of people who will fail to get their health results if they do not address radiation on its own specifically. And even further than that, we have so many people who have come to us and only purchased the protection devices, and maybe they've done a few of these other things like minimize exposure and shield sources, maybe, I don't know. But I do know that they purchased devices and they got a health result. Often that health problem is in a category that I would call completely nutritional. But if the EMF is affecting their blood, which we know it is, then those nutrients can't get to where they need to go. Why I said all that is because in this business, we are actually selling things. We give away a lot of information about foods to avoid and protective strategies like we just talked about. But those free things, we can't measure them. We can't really follow up with them. We don't know if people did all these things. The only thing we know in a lot of cases is that they consumed the supplements or they bought the protective device and they put it on their body and they either did or did not get a result. So now as we're talking about devices, I have to say that most of my testimonials have to do with the frequency tuning discs that we've been promoting for many years now. To me, they are the single cheapest and most effective EMF protecting device, and every single human being and pet, in my opinion, should wear at least one on their body. I personally wear 4, and right at this moment, I'm wearing 6. That is 2 on a bracelet, on both wrists, and 2 on an anklet. Normally, we would say 4 is around the maximum. I just had an extra bracelet, so I'm wearing it. But these things are much cheaper than other similar devices, and we've tested them over many years with many people and animals, and I've seen nothing outperform the frequency tuning discs, either in price or effectiveness. Now, we've tested pretty much every bracelet and ion and magnet and all these, everything that you can think of, we've tested it, and very little comes anywhere near the value of a frequency tuning disc. First of all, we'll have a sign up, something to grab their attention so they come in and talk to us, and when they ask about what it is that we're doing, we'll ask if they have any pains anywhere, and we'll ask if they want to see a demonstration of what the disc does. Now, if they say they have any pains anywhere, our strategy is to actually tape one of those discs to them in that spot of their pain, and then keep talking to them. And it's actually a good chance that their pain will go away within the few minutes that we have to talk to them. And we'll use that as a selling point. Assuming that, of course, whatever benefit they get from the disc is going to be much greater over time than it will be in a few minutes. But it is fantastic that we usually can see results within a few minutes. Now, if they agree to the demonstration, we will show them how weak they are with a cell phone in their pocket. There's many ways to demonstrate strength or balance. This is our favorite way to do it. Because we can do it with pretty much anybody, whether they're old or young or fat or slim or muscular, And because it's really easy, there's no extra training that you need. Anybody can do it. A lot of these people go home and try and do it with their people that they know, and they can do it. They can show a big difference between people's strength and balance with a cell phone in their pocket and without a cell phone in their pocket. So that's the first part of our demonstration here. We're showing people that they're weaker with the cell phone in than they are with the cell phone out. And then we go ahead and we put the cell phone back in their hand or in their pocket. And then we'll add a frequency tuning disc either to their wrist or underneath their shoe, which shows that it's not conductive, by the way. It's not conducting electricity through a rubber sole or through a steel toe boot. But we'll introduce a disc and they have their phone back on them, and we'll show them that they are stronger now, even stronger than they were without the phone, because they have been enhanced by the frequencies that are embedded into that disc. And those frequencies are those found in our nervous system, muscular system, and skeletal system. Most similar devices that I'm aware of use the earth frequency to embed into their device. Now, we do show some sort of result with that, but it's nowhere near as strong as we get with the frequency tuning discs, and it's nowhere near as consistent. And when a frequency tuning disc is already present, we cannot see any clear-cut benefit by using the earth frequency on top of the frequency tuning discs. Sometimes we get subjective results, which I do. I have other things that I wear, and I have a subjective feeling that it's good, but I don't feel an extra physical benefit or have any proof that it's doing anything more than the frequency tuning discs. Now, why I hovered on the discs is, again, because they are cheap, they are effective, they are durable, they will last an entire lifetime, whereas a lot of the other devices on the market, even some of the other ones that I sell, and I do sell the frequency tuning discs, you can find them on the website, and the link is in the description. But a lot of these other things are pendants. A lot of them are put into stones or quartz or moonstone or something like that, and it's just bulkier. I don't like wearing pendants to bed. I often break the chain if I do that. I don't wear pendants or necklaces into the shower as well, whereas the frequency tuning disc is a brass disc. You can wear it anywhere. We sell them on steel bracelets, but people make all kinds of their own bracelets or necklaces, or some of them just rivet it into a belt or something. As long as it's near the body, because it does work through a shoe or a steel toe boot, we know it doesn't need to touch the skin. It just needs to be near the body, very close to the body. So with these devices, they are collectible, and I would start with the frequency tuning discs. There are other things. I do wear an EP2 pendant. Now, this is a patented product. The frequency tuning discs are not a patented product. This is a similar concept, although again, it is different. And of course, you can't wear it 24/7 because it is a pendant, a rather bulky one at that. But I do recommend it. And since they are collectible, we can do one after another. We should also talk about structured water here as well. I know we're in the category of protection devices, and that I mentioned that I don't think nutrition is the key factor for protecting ourselves from radiation. Despite having said that, structured water is the way water is supposed to be delivered into our body, into our cells. We are mostly water. And that whole blood problem that we were talking about with radiation affecting the blood vessels crinkling up and not being able to get where they need to go, and basically messing up the nutrition system because the nutrition can't get to where it needs to go. Well, that whole blood system and all those blood cells and all that stuff, everything involved here is mostly water, right? So the structure of that water is extremely important. And if we are going to do anything specifically nutritionally to support our body's ability to protect itself against EMF, that would be to consume structured water regularly. Now, the same company that makes the EP2 pendant here also makes a very good structured water. I don't have that much experience with multiple types of structured water, so I can't really compare them, but it does pretty well on price comparison, and it has very good results. It's called Quanta Water. And the protocol for this is to take a cap full every 30 minutes when you first start this. Every 30 minutes on a timer, a little teaspoonful. And this is providing a catalyst for the structure that already exists in your water to convert itself into a more natural, more resilient structure. And I hope this didn't just get too complicated, but the structure of our cells and of our bodies is what produces our electrical aura. We are electrical beings. We must consume what they call electrolytes every single day. These are water-soluble electrical nutrients, particularly salt, the B vitamins, vitamin C, and many other key minerals. And all of that stuff exists within a substrate of water. So structured water, some way, some form, is, in my opinion, in the same category as protective devices. And they're also not cheap. Minimizing exposure is pretty much free. Shields can be very, very cheap. But these devices are more expensive, and so is structured water. There are filters that claim to structure the water. There are vortexes that you can buy, either a spout for your tap to vortex the water, or a water receptacle with a vortex spout on the bottom of it. These are goals that we should have. These will all structure the water to a certain degree. Now, water is also structured when it is absorbed into the tissues of plants, and this is why juicing, which concentrates the good stuff in plants, is also an excellent source of structured water. You could even just drink like coconut water or something like that. That's structured water, as long as it hasn't been bastardized in processing and transport and such. Anyways, learn about structured water and try to incorporate that in your life. Next, you can buy things in the house. My favorite house device is a salt lamp, because they are pretty cheap as well, and you can put them all over the house. These will be emitting negative ions. Now, the bad radiation is made up of what they call positive ions. So the bad ones are called positive and the good ones are called negative. Now, salt lamps emit negative ions. So do oceans and beaches and forests and mountains. These are all good places to be to surround yourself in negative ions. And grounding as well, we can put that in this category as well. Negative ions flowing up through the soles of our feet, either by walking barefoot on the earth or on rocks or on the beach, or even using a grounding blanket or grounding shoes, because these negative ions counteract the positive ones and neutralize them. They also pull particles out of the air, dust and irritants and stuff like that. Now, I do have a Schumann generator, which generates the Schumann resonance frequency. There's a lot of different opinions on this. I don't personally feel that much of a difference from it, especially because it's next to a big salt lamp. I definitely feel the salt lamp. I do not like it when it's off. I like to keep them on 24/7. But adding the Schumann generator hasn't really added much, in my opinion. And there are those who say that we really shouldn't be generating our own frequencies. It's okay to have things with frequencies embedded into them, or things that release negative ions into the atmosphere. But generating our own frequencies is basically risky business, and it's quite a complicated answer that I've gotten from many people, but that's the gist of it that I've got. So I don't know if my Schumann generator is good or bad, and I'm not going to recommend it here. But be aware that there are a lot of types of electrical devices that are marketed by putting frequencies into the atmosphere. I would stay away from those. I would look more towards the things that produce negative ions and the things that protect your body directly. On a bigger scale, there are some devices that can, for instance, clean the electricity in your house, but most of these are marketed towards industrial businesses because they will have a lot of dirty electricity created in their manufacturing. So basically, this device can clean the electricity so it's not filled with a whole bunch of conflicting frequencies, which is part of the problem here in our EMF exposure. It's not that we're being introduced to specific smooth frequencies, we're being introduced to a clutter, a cloud of a messy mix of counteracting frequencies. So this dirty static electricity can be a problem in our electricity bills and in the efficiency of our machines, but of course we're also saying that this contributes to the health concern. So you can clean the electricity in your house. That is a more technical option. You can get off the grid even better, but that's not practical for most people as a starting point. And that would bring us to our fourth major thing that you can and should do. I know we said there were only three things, but in reality there are four things. We can minimize our exposure, we can shield our major sources, and we can buy protective devices. That is all completely within our control. But the problem itself is not within our control. That's why number four is political. We have to be involved in some way in the political movement to make people aware of this problem first, so that we can act on it second. The easiest form of that is sharing information. I mentioned the book The Invisible Rainbow. I highly recommend buying that book and sharing it. I've read several books on the subject, and that is the most comprehensive and the easiest to understand from a layperson, in my opinion. Buy that book and share it. Lend it out. Tell your friend or your mother or your wife or your husband that you want it back in less than a month so you can loan it out again. This is the basis of the network marketing strategy, and although you are not selling a physical product, you are selling an idea. And if you are aware of the magnitude of this problem, you will understand the necessity of political action here, and we can participate in political action at a small scale, number one, by sharing information and by helping the people closest to us understand this. Even better would be to teach them to do the same thing that you just did. Buy a copy of the book and share it. Find your favorite videos on the subject and share them. Create your own videos, even better. There's many things in this category. Again, a lot of them are small. You can put up posters. You can create art or incorporate it into your songs if you're an artist. You can wear t-shirts. But first and foremost, you can make yourself available to help educate and train other people on the subject. And you can study sales and communication and get yourself better prepared to communicate these ideas on a wider scale or in a political setting. Now, I don't have any political power, really. I have the ability to make videos and talk on the internet, and that's what I do. But some people will have the ability to make political actions. Some people will be business owners, politicians, concerned parents, teachers, administrators of all kinds, and it's those types of people where we really need to get the information to, because that's where we need the momentum to actually start making changes. Why do I say all this? Because there has only been a few cell phone towers that have been taken down. I'm not aware of any transfer stations, like electricity step-down stations or anything like that. I'm not aware of any of that being moved because of complaints of health concerns anywhere in the world. I'm not aware of residential areas being cleared away from subway lines due to a health concern from the EMF. And in America, I'm pretty sure it's not even legal to sue a cell phone tower company or bring any court case forward only on health. All of the towers I've seen taken down politically that made the news were done so on aesthetic grounds. This means people argued that it lowered their property values or their views, and they successfully got a cell phone tower taken down. You can imagine the types of people that are more inclined to do that type of action. They're going to be wealthier people. So wherever you are in the spectrum or the age or whatever you're capable of, you can pick something politically that you can do, and do not neglect the sharing of information, because again, if you're not one of those powerful people, you might be able to reach them using content or even using old school sales tactics such as lending a book. And I did mention it, but I will finish this video off with saying that if we do live in a city, we must be aware that this problem is not going anywhere and it is getting rapidly worse. Now, this has been a huge problem for a long time, and we are very late to the table in understanding how big of a problem this is. It is my solid opinion that no matter what supplements you take, no matter what food you eat, no matter how well you exercise and take care of yourself, you cannot be perfectly healthy in a city, even a big town, in my opinion. Most particularly if you live next to a major source, cell phone tower, step down station, subway station, high voltage power line. And if you do live very close to one of those sources, you have to move. Have to move. There's nothing that will protect you from those major sources. You can cover your whole house in EMF protecting paint and tinfoil and all this, and you will be trapped in a Faraday cage, and it probably still will not fix the problem. It will probably still not negate the harm. On top of that, life is, in my opinion, better in the country. I've lived in many cities and suburbs and rural areas, and I 100% believe that life is better away from the cities. Now that I know about radiation and know that I am sensitive to radiation as well, I feel physically amazing out in the country. Living is cheap, there's no traffic, pretty much everything is easier. And I'll bet a lot of people who have lived in the city and suburbs their whole life have no idea how valuable actual peace and quiet can be. But I will tell you, if you've never considered leaving the city, think about it. First of all, you will greatly reduce your EMF exposure. It is the single biggest thing that any of us can do to reduce our EMF exposure, is moving away from the biggest sources, which are cities and big towns. And number two, we can decrease our cost of living and probably free up a lot of time for us to pursue our real interests in life. And I'm not going to go on too much about this. I just want to mention that this is not just a problem that we can simply buy our way out of or simply change our habits and fix it. Because it's not our habits that's causing the problem. It's the way that we collect and distribute energy that is the problem. And the fact that we have industries that have paid no mind to our health when designing wireless technologies, that has to change. Demand from the consumers, which is us, has to change, and these companies will respond. In several countries, cell phone companies do block the radiation going into the head of the user by putting a plate there. Cell phone companies are aware of this problem. In the insert of your phone, it very likely tells you not to put it directly to your head. And in other countries, there is sufficient demand that the companies have had to make their products safer. We have to do the same thing in the rest of the world. And since we are nowhere near that, the imperative is to share information about this and to do these things yourself so that you can be a good example. You can stand by these things in casual conversations and influence the people around you basically forever, because this is not something we're going to fix tomorrow. So that's pretty much everything I wanted to mention. Actually went longer than I expected to. These are the main things that we can do to protect ourselves, even though there are other things. This is enough to get started. So for today, that's all I've got. I appreciate you. Until next time. And definitely check out my book, Fake Diseases. It covers all of the major topics that come up, like birth defects, blood sugar problems, bone and joint problems, cancer, autoimmune problems, and more. And it's on Amazon for just $9.99. And the audiobook read-along version is free here on YouTube, and the link for that is in the description of this video. I'm very excited to announce my newest book, Everything the Government Does is Bad for Us. And you can get the paperback on Amazon for just $9.99, and you can find the video read-along version or the audiobook on my website, noticebooks.org. And all of my books, audiobooks, and links are available on my website, noticebooks.org. And for more health information, make sure to check out our YouTube or our Instagram. And you can actually message us there on the Instagram account and we will respond to every message. And if you want to see what is apparently my most controversial video that was banned from YouTube and BitChute, you can go to wagthedogtheory.com and view the whole uncensored version of the video. And I recommend downloading it if it is still there.